Trump term two will focus on trade. Trump is not interested in going to war with anybody, but he understands the power of economic warfare. So I think that's the direction that you would see for Trump term two. What do you see Biden in term one? Again, I'm a Trump person. I was one of the people that created the Trump foreign policy doctrine, America first, peace through strength, et cetera. So I'm going to be probably less positive about a Biden term. But from what Biden has already said, he wants to have a version of the Iran nuclear deal that he would revive. Once you do that, I think it endangers Israeli Sunni Arab peace agreements in the region, because then everybody will start, you know, what's in it for me? And they're going to be very nervous about Iran having breakout nuclear weapons. If Iran has an economy that starts thriving again, which is one of the terms of the original Iran nuclear deal, then Iran might decide to get more involved in sponsoring terrorist activities. That's there. In Europe, you know, Trump is going to continue to say, everybody in NATO, you pay up. You know, we're not going to continue to subsidize and underwrite NATO. I think Biden would, I'm not sure what he would do differently. I don't think his tone will be better. I don't think he'll hector the Europeans as much, but I also don't think a Biden presidency would be as eager to rush into a US-UK trade deal as Trump would be. I mean, Latin America, Biden administration, I think there'll be an easing of the issues of immigration. I'm not sure the issue of immigration really is gonna be that first and foremost going forward, just because the economies aren't going to attract it the same way that they have. In Asia, though, would be the big difference. I mean, if past is prologue to the future, Vice President Biden was, in the Obama administration, despite the rhetoric, they really stepped back from the South China Sea and did not challenge the Chinese air identification zones or their attempts to make China the sort of sole determinant of the South China Sea and the Malacca Straits and the trade route. As China builds out in its 10, 20 year, 50 year plan, as they continue to build out a one trade, one belt, one road, a maritime trade route as well as the Silk Route. And then as they build a cyber Silk Route with a 5G Huawei, that's what they'll be wanting to do. And I think that you'll see great reluctance on the part of a Biden administration to challenge that. The other thing I would point out is that, you know, 4 years ago, or even 2 years ago, the image of China in the United States was not as malign as it is now. Even Joe Biden was saying 6 months ago, hey man, China, they're not a real threat to us. Whereas Trump was saying that they are. And I think that the national mood, Republicans and Democrats, has really changed. That no matter who's president, there will be there's not going to be happy, harmonious relationship between the United States and China going forward. If the Chinese want to have it, fine. I think that either Trump or Biden administration would eagerly embrace that. But if their objective is, as they make no secret of, to replace the United States by, and originally it was mid-century, now they're talking about by 2025 even, to replace the United States as the dominant world power technologically and economically, and then rewrite the rules of order of the international community according to Chinese characteristics, then I think that both a Biden and a Trump administration would look not favorably on that. Trump would be tougher on them, Biden, but it would be very difficult for any American president now to fully embrace China.
Thank you, Katie. That's a really helpful roundup of the broader international relations for the US. In terms of the immediate future, knowing Trump and his team as well as you do, how do you see the next week, month potentially playing out? And how should, you know, the broader international investment community be thinking about, you know, the opportunities and pitfalls ahead of us?
Well, I think we're in for about a 2 week period of great uncertainty. It's hard to describe the American system to anybody, especially the electoral system, because it's so complicated. But it's important to remember, we didn't just have one presidential election, we have 50. each state gets to decide who votes, how they vote, how it's calculated, when they vote. And that's what we're in the middle of now. And the states which still have not put out their results, certified their result, are the swing states. So when by Friday, we should have vote counts tallied from at least two of the five swing states. And we will probably know at least better. Now, my guess is that no matter who wins some of these states, there will be a challenge from the other party. So let's say, for example, Trump wins Pennsylvania. The Democrats will say, well, wait a minute, Trump, you know, there was something fishy going on with Trump and the ballots coming out of Pennsylvania, Western Pennsylvania. If Biden wins, Trump will say, well, there's the governor, the Democrat governor of Pennsylvania continued to allow votes to be counted a week after the election. That's unconstitutional. So you'd have a Supreme Court fight. Arizona, I was just reading that. So Arizona has certified that it went for Trump, but now there are 500,000 votes that have somehow been discovered somewhere. And do those count? Do they not count? If they don't count, why? And if they do count, who do they favor? Trump, Biden, who knows? But I think in the broader picture of what's happening in America right now, I think that America's in one of these periods of rapid technological, economic, social change. And that I believe that this happens roughly every 40 years in America, where the Washington establishment, the ruling class, whatever you want to call them, that they get so disconnected from the average voter that the average voter rebels and says, look, we've got stale leadership. They're not solving our problems. We want to go in a very different direction. And that's why the Republican Party turned to Trump. And I think that's why the Democrats are doing the same thing. And they're looking at Bernie Sanders. They're flirting with socialism and the far left. So there's an upheaval like this that takes place periodically in America. And I think that's what we're seeing. It's a rejection of the status quo. And so it's not so much the way to think about it. It's not so much Republicans versus Democrats. Is Washington, D.C. ruling class versus the rest of the country. All the reaction, a lot of the Trump voters, they hate Washington. They think Washington's a bunch of elitists. Similarly, on the Democrat side, they think Washington's a bunch of elitists and that somehow their interests are not being served. So I think the United States is going to continue to go through this period, probably for several years, no matter who's elected president. And we do this throughout our history. We go through these very periods of creative destruction. They're unsettling. We went through them, the American Revolution in the 1770s. We went through them again in the 1830s. We went through them during the Civil War, during the Industrial Revolution, during the Great Depression and World War II. And they tend to take it's not a one election solves all problems. It usually takes 5, 7, 10 years. But when you emerge from this period of creative destruction, it's usually a very different group of leaders going in a very different direction. And a lot of it is triggered by technological change and communications change and just societal changes.
Katie, thank you so much for speaking to us on what is such a busy day after the election.